Okay, we are live. Hello, everyone. Welcome to the OnStage podcast. I'm your host, Chris Robert. Today we have a really wonderful, you will not believe this. She's a mathematician, a magician, and a musician. Try saying that fast. So we're going to introduce her now. Ladies and gentlemen, Tori Noquez, magician, mathematician, and musician.
Hi, hey. Thank you for having me.
You're very welcome, Tori. Thanks for being on the show. Would you like to give us a little bit of some information about like backstory of who you are for people who don't know you?
Sure. So, I guess we'll start. I'll go through them in order. So I'm a mathematician. I'm a professor of mathematics. I'm currently at Indiana University in Bloomington. And I do research in a branch of math called formal logic. So it's just very pure abstract math. And I get to think about like weird made up universes of math and kind of figure out what goes on there and prove stuff about it. And I think it's really great. I get to be really creative. On the maybe apparently opposite side of the spectrum, though in my mind they're very similar, I also do magic professionally. So I got into magic about maybe 12 years ago. I visited the Magic Castle in Hollywood for the first time. And I just thought it was so cool. I had never done magic. I didn't grow up doing magic, which is a very typical story for most magicians. I had never done a card trick or really been exposed to magic at all until I was 22. And I visited the Magic Castle. I was living in LA at the time. And I just thought it was so awesome that I went home and I signed up for the classes that they offer at the Magic Castle. And I just like ran with it. Now I do it professionally. So that's kind of, it's been a really, really fun journey. And then a musician. Yeah, that one's more for funnies. I don't do that professionally at all, but I've always played music. And I guess like math and magic, it's a place where I get to be creative. And there's a lot of like patterns to it. When I was working on my PhD, I was in a garage band with three other mathematicians. I play drums. These are sort of my things. And in all of them, I get to be really creative. I get to meet a lot of really interesting people. I get to be on stage. So yeah, that's kind of my shtick.
That is amazing. I really loved every word of that. Yeah.
Thank you.
But so what were you first, a mathematician, a musician, or a magician?
Well, I guess if I'm answering that question most honestly, first I was more, as a kid, I was always like a science kid. So I was like the president of the Rocket Club and did like robotics competitions and stuff. And so I was really into space growing up. That was like my thing. I like went to space camp and it was like, that was my, my jam. Yeah. And then at some point, maybe mid high school, I was getting more serious about, I started taking like AP physics and chemistry and stuff. I realized that the parts of science that I was like most excited about were the theoretical parts. And so that's what sort of like sent me thinking about like, okay, the part of this that I like is theory. So what is that theory? Oh, it's math. And then, oh, there's actually this whole side of math that's like totally abstract. And that's like the part I was most interested in. So that's kind of how I like made that route. So definitely was doing math, kind of science to math, I guess. And then I don't know, music wise, I always played music growing up. But it was always just like, it's kind of this thing that's, it's always been in my life, but I've never sort of pursued it at like a performance level or anything, or like I didn't try to go to school for it or anything like that. So yeah, those guys kind of coincided. Magic came a lot later. Like I said, it wasn't until I was out of college, I was in my early 20s when I first sort of landed on magic as a thing. And I'd always been interested in performance art. Like I've always played music and I never like kind of got to the level of performing or even kind of writing much of my own. And I sort of found my way to the stage, I guess you could say, in magic. It kind of became a thing that I was both really excited about and had the knack for in some vague sense. So, I was always, there was always so much to learn in it and so much to do. And I just like, it gave me kind of a creative outlet in which I could pursue a performance art and like get myself on stage and start performing in a regular way. So that's kind of one of the motivating things besides that, just that I love magic. So yeah, that's kind of, those are sort of the progression. Yeah.
I love that. So, but what was your childhood like?
So like, I think as a kid, maybe could have told you, I probably knew who David Copperfield was. I probably knew who Penn and Teller were, but I'd never like been to a magic show. I didn't, you know, I had maybe seen like, maybe at like kids' birthday parties I went to as a kid or something, but I was never exposed to it. It's just something I knew very little about. You know, when I was in college, Arrested Development was really popular. And so like, you kind of see a depiction of magicians there, but like, it wasn't something I knew really anything about. I didn't know who Vax Maven was. I didn't know who, I just wasn't in magic at all, which like I said, is kind of unusual. You know, most magicians, you ask them, oh, tell us your journey in magic. Oh, well, when I was 4 years old, I got my first magic kit, or, you know, like there's a very common route. So yeah, I guess my experience is a little bit unusual in that as a kid, I was just not part of it. And I think there's some kind of maybe benefit or silver lining to that, just in that, I'll say it like this, magic is hard. And I am glad that I started learning as an adult when I had a lot more patience than I ever did as a little child. because, you know, it's, as anyone who does any magic knows, there's an extremely steep learning curve to both the technical aspect and becoming a performer. And so both of those require a massive amount of patience, which, you know, not, I get frustrated like all people as an adult or otherwise, but yeah, it's kind of some small benefit. But when I was first breaking into the magic community, I was coming from way behind because like you just asked, like, who did you know? I didn't know anything. So yeah, it was kind of an unusual route, I guess.
Did that trick that you did in front of Penn and Teller, did that take you long to learn, or did you just use the power of mathematics to get that to show up as four of hearts?
Yeah, well, I'll tell you this, it's not a math trick. It's sleight of hand. It's an original trick I created for the show with some collaboration. The process was a little more like, I had this idea for the main idea that I wanted to build. I'm going to assume anybody listening has watched the trick. And if you haven't, you should check it out.
It'll be in the description of a YouTube video. Yeah, people can watch that episode. Yes.
Perfect. Good. So press pause and watch the trick and then I'll tell you about it. So the main sort of idea I had was around a simultaneous reveal. So having like a bunch of the same card revealed all at once visually. So I had seen something kind of similar. I'd never seen anything like that where it was visual, like on the stage. Blake Voigt had a really cool trick where he had something where envelopes were like taped under people's like chairs in the audience. And there was something where like you tear them open and like one of them has a chosen card or something like this. So there was something where there were like a lot of cards out in the audience and like the reveal was happening kind of simultaneously across like a bunch of cards. And I thought that was really cool. So that was sort of the idea I was building upon. And then twofold. One was that I wanted that to then play from the stage, like for TV, for example. But also one of the big factors in how the trick was developed was knowing that Fool Us was filming without an audience because of COVID. So right. I couldn't do anything like where a bunch of audience members had to like do anything. It was just Penn and Teller and Allison. So,
and you couldn't even get close to them either, could you? Or did you have to take COVID tests? No.
Yeah. So there was a lot of rules around testing. It was it was filmed in June 2021. So a lot of the sort of mask mandates and stuff were less, especially in Vegas. But on set, there were TV union rules. So we were all masked between takes and we had to take COVID tests every 3 days. So yeah, they had pretty strict guidelines and it felt very safe and no one got sick as far as I know. So, but yeah, they did have guidelines about like if you're having somebody pick a card, they were supposed to be like two arm lengths apart and things like this. So they did have interaction. And if you watch the season, there are tricks in which people are like physically picking cards and things like this. But I didn't use that in mine. and I didn't need to, but yeah. So, in any case, so those sort of factors kind of, are what sort of led to the idea of this board, of having them vertically on a board that I could flip over and show. Yeah. And then it became sort of exercise in developing the sort of mechanism. And so I consulted with Brent Braun, who owns a magic shop here in Indiana, and a little theater that's really great. I reached out to him because I knew he had worked with many acts on the show. And he had a really good idea about some mechanism for the trick that wound up being a really like pivotal suggestion. And then once I had the attention of the producers, I had been talking back and forth with them. I hadn't been cast yet, but they liked the idea. And so then I had a Zoom meeting with Mike Close, who is their magic consultant, who is him and Johnny Thompson, who did it. And now it's just him. And that was like getting to work with him was really exciting. Cause he works on all of these things. And we talked a little bit more about some of the mechanism and the sort of the, like how the trick would work. And then he had a lot of suggestions about the premise and just how it would be presented. So my original idea for the trick, it played a little differently where maybe I would find a chosen card on the board and then they would find something or not find it. And then there'd be some reveal or something. So he really streamlined it into what it wound up being. And then after that, I wrote the script and they gave me a few tweaks, but I was actually really proud. They were really cool about, I basically performed what I wrote. So they gave me a few sort of lines and tweaks, but for the most part, I got to perform what I created. So, that was very cool. So that's kind of how that got put together.
Wow. Why didn't they just let you perform your trick without giving you any, tweaks or whatever?
Well, I was glad to have them. So, no, not at all. I think it was a collaboration. So, these are people. So first of all, one thing, and I had gotten this advice or read this advice and I was glad I'd heard it, is that TV magic is a little different than performing on a stage for live people. So there, it's nuanced. The differences are very nuanced, but slightly different approaches can make it sort of present better on TV than you would do like for a live audience. So these are people who obviously they've been producing the show for 8 years, who know what they're doing with TV magic, whereas I'd never been on TV before. So it was, these are people who like have insight into sort of that aspect of it. But besides that, a lot of these people like Mike, their magic consultant, have been doing this for a long, long time and had really good ideas. And one of the things about it that I think was really, really cool and respectful is that with the tweaks to the script and even to the sort of the presentation, like it was collaborative. None of them said, you know what, you need to do it this way. And it was always like, hey, why don't you try this? Or why are you doing this like this? And even in our process of like the rehearsals, so we had Zoom rehearsals leading up to the taping. And so for example, there's one thing where if you watch the clip, I walk back and forth in front of the board a bunch of times. And during the Zoom rehearsals, one of the producers asked, like, why are you going back and forth? Do you need to do that? And I was like, well, no, it's natural for me. I teach and that's part of, I walk back and forth in front of the chalkboard. And that's just, I move around a lot when I'm performing. And then one of the other producers was like, no, you should keep it up. If that's how you present, that's how you should do it. So it was a conversation. It wasn't a, hey, you need to do this. Or like another thing, the night before filming, if you look at the board, the cards are taped on there with like blue masking tape. And the night before filming, one of the producers or prop designers, I guess, approached me and was like, hey, I have this black tape you can use. It'll look a little nicer. And I was like, absolutely not. I can't change the tape the night before. I know how sticky it is. I know how it feels. I know it doesn't tear the cards. Like, I'm not changing it now. And then they were super cool about it. They were like, oh, no, don't worry. Like, it was just an offer. It looks great. It's fine. So, all of their suggestions were exactly that, their suggestions. And they were very willing to work with me. And that's the thing about Fool Us as a show is that their whole goal is to make magicians look good, you know? So, and they specialize in showing magic, you know? It's not like some of these other shows where there's all different types of performers. And so sometimes the magic doesn't get showcased quite right. So yeah, it was a great creative experience. Everybody was really both helpful and respectful in the sort of creative process.
Yeah. Steve Brundage is on America's Got Talent. He did the Rubik's Cube trick where he placed it into a bag. And when he took it out of the bag, it was already solved.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
And Sydney told me how that was done.
Oh, yeah.
And sorry, folks. Can't reveal that one.
Nope.
And also, I've been watching... Before Allison, I've been watching Penn and Teller when they had that English guy, whatever.
Right.
And many of them have some. Yes. And I saw some really outrageous tricks. And I'm trying to figure out, like, how is it done? And so I look on the internet and they say David Copperfield's flying trick and to tell you how he did it. Remember that? I don't know if you've seen that one where he flew around the audience.
Yeah, yeah, I have seen that one, yeah.
They show you how they do that one. And another one is how, when I think it was Jay Sankey, I think, when he got the CN Tower to disappear. CN Tower. He got the CN Tower to disappear and how that was done. And I'm like, obviously. there's always a trick behind it. There's no real warlocks or there's no... Samantha Stevens out there who can just suddenly wiggle her nose and make things disappear.
No, it's a skill set like any other skill set.
Yeah. Have you seen the interesting iPhone trick apps that they have?
I'm not super familiar with a lot of them, but I know there's a lot of them out there and it's like this really rapidly developing field of magic. There's a lot of really cool stuff.
You can put like a coin inside the iPhone and then you have to like you have to go like this and make it drop right into your hand. But the way you do it, it's just everything has to be so pristine and so perfect, or you're going to end up doing what I did and have things fall and you're like, oops, sorry.
We all do that sometimes. That's part of the process.
I remember doing performing my card tricks in front of my some coworkers. Mm-hmm. And for joke, one guy went into the deck of cards and he took the chosen card and hit it just to trick me. But when I was able to perform the trick anyway, they were just like, how did you do that? I took the card out and they were just shocked. I was like, well, the card's right here, but how did you? It was so funny. I had no idea the guy was going to ruin it for me, but he didn't ruin it for me. He actually made it better.
He made it stronger. That's lucky that that's how that went, because there are always hecklers and people trying to like challenge the performer and it's, you know.
Yeah. Have you ever done the surgical card through window trick?
No.
We can actually take the card from the other side of the window out.
Oh, that's cool.
There's a special move. If you go on YouTube and you type in surgical card through window, you'll probably get that. Penguin Magic, I believe it's Penguin Magic. What's the other company that sells magic?
Vanishing Ink?
Yeah, how'd you know?
Vanishing Ink, yeah. And, I know a little bit about magic.
Yeah, of course. And it shows you how to perform this trick called Chaos.
Okay.
Which allows you to, someone take a chosen card, and then you put the card into the deck, and it's mixed, the card is mixed up. And you go to the other side of the window and you say, spread the cards against the window. So they spread the cards against the window and you're on the other side and you're going, this is hard. And then you pull it out from the other side of the window and they're like going, whoa, why did you do that? And then there's this one. See all these cards? Right?
Sure. Yep.
Okay. Now, oop. Now they're all blue.
Oh, nice. Oh, that's good.
Well, actually, it does a lot more, to it, but I have all these card tricks. I'm more like a cardician.
Sure, me too.
And then the disappearing ink pen where you sign a card and it disappears.
Oh, yeah, those are fun. Yeah.
If you take a match and you put it under a signature or whatever, it disappears.
Yeah,
you can.
Yeah.
And you got to remember you got the handkerchief one too with the trick, you know.
Of course. Yeah. 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 That's a classic.
Yep. So I got a lot of tricks here. Now, what I have to do is I have to go through them and try to figure out which ones I'm going to keep and which ones, like,
it's an ongoing battle.
I remember when I was a kid, I created this trick where you take a plastic, I don't know, something plastic, and you put it in between this piece of cardboard, and you can put like knitting needles or something through it.
Okay.
And then you show people that as you take a knitting needle away, it goes back to normal. I said, where are the holes? There's no holes on this thing. Nice. So I made my own tricks when I was younger. I saw this guy when I was a kid. It's a long time ago. He'd take a record album, vinyl record album, and he'd show that all the records are black, of course, vinyl.
Sure.
Then he'd take a color handkerchief and he'd put it through the hole.
Mm-hmm.
And as soon as he pulled the record out, it was that color of the anchor.
Oh, that's really creative. That's awesome.
So I made my own.
Mm-hmm.
And I made my own, and you can only do the trick once, because after the second or third time, they will know how you did it.
So, right. Yeah, that's sort of a rule of magic. You shouldn't be performing the same thing more than once for the same audience.
Yeah.
Because a lot of misdirection is in the timing, you know?
Yeah, I learned that. So, when you create a magic trick, what is a creative process? How do you go about making it work? And why does it take so many months or years to make it work perfectly?
It varies by trick. So I think there are a lot of different levels of creation in magic. So there's creating like a technical mechanism, like a sleight with cards or like a physical prop. And then there's also creating a plot or a premise for a trick. So like I talked about in my, you know, in my Foolish thing, I had this idea of the simultaneous reveal. And then what? How do I use it? How do I create a trick out of it? How do I make it a routine that has an interesting story in it? So there's all these different levels. And I think that a lot of creation in magic, you know, most magicians or many magicians that you see performing in any given venue, for the most part, are performing material that is not purely original. So a lot of standards of magic are being performed by many different performers. But one of the things that will set modern performers apart, and I think is really important in approaching this art form, is creating an original and personal presentation. So a lot of the creative work that I do towards like putting together a show. So for example, in my Magic Castle act, like I open with my Foolish routine, which is original and mine, but then a lot of the other tricks I go on to perform are standards of magic, but they're written with original presentation. So that alone can be part of, you know, the sort of creation process, is figuring out how to make it sort of your presentation. And one of the reasons that takes a long time is one of the, like, for me at least, and for a lot of people, key sort of components to creating a successful routine and a successful script is just flight time with it. So just performing it for real audiences and listening to reactions and hearing which jokes land and which jokes don't, and like the timing of the trick and the build of the routine. You got to do it in front of real people, because you can write the trick and practice it yourself a million times, which I always do first. And then you get it in front of an audience and it plays completely differently than you anticipate. So one of the longest parts of the process of perfecting a routine, or at least polishing a routine, is getting it out there in front of people. And that was one of the scary things about my Foolish performance, is doing it for Penn and Teller was the first time. Well, it was the first time I performed that trick live. And it was also my first time performing live in 18 months after the pandemic. So my first live audience was Penn and Teller, which was really exciting and a little bit scary. But I mean, it was a really positive experience. But Yeah, so kind of that airtime with audiences, and that's, you know, that's a tough thing to build, because it's like, well, how do you get better? You perform more shows, but how do you get shows? You have to be good to get booked at venues, or, you know, so it's kind of this like, it's a complicated process to break in, but there are lots of different ways to do it. So yeah, that's what I think is the longest part in creating a routine and making it good, is figuring out how to make it yours and how to make it play for real people, which is yeah, it's a tough part of the process, but I think it's a really fun part of the process too. Yeah, one thing that I've found really helpful in, you know, rehearsing a new technique like the one you described with the window, is to film it from a bunch of different angles. So if I'm working on like a new card slide or something, I'll set my phone up like in different parts of the room, and I'll do it, and then I'll look at it and see how it looks. And that can tell you a lot about how it's going to look for real people.
Wow. I'll take that advice.
Yeah, you can have that one. That, and also, honestly, lay people forget really quickly, even if they figure out a trick. So you'll hear lay people come out of a show and say like, oh, I know how they did this. It was blah, blah, blah. And if you go to the same people like 3 hours later in the night, and say like, oh, what was that trick? You figured it out? They're not gonna remember. So lay people who figure out magic tricks have a very short memory for them. If you remember, there was this like masked magician show that was on TV for a while, where it was like some dude revealing tricks. This was like 10 or 15 years ago, or maybe longer. I don't really remember. It was a long time ago. But and a lot of people were really like up in arms about this guy's revealing our secrets. And like, honestly, if you like surveyed a bunch of people who watched it, they couldn't tell you what they saw or learned. They'd watch it and be like, oh, that's how that like sawing a person in half works. But they couldn't repeat it days later. So people have short memories.
On YouTube, there's this guy and he reacts to people doing tricks. Mm-hmm. You ever heard of Chris Ramsey? He's also another magician.
Yeah, of course. Yeah.
He does excellent tricks, but he also has one on YouTube, and he also has one on Facebook, where he will see someone perform a trick and you try to figure it out, or he'll go like, wait, how do you do that?
Right.
And I saw this one guy, and I think he's from Korea, whatever. Mm-hmm. And it's a film where they show you no camera tricks, and you see him going right inside a moving subway and out again. You see him take like a book or something, and he'll go like this, and he'll be inside his chest, and then he'll take it out of his ear or something. But it's gotta be camera tricks. You can't really, like, how would you do that? How would you learn a trick where you're just running right into a subway car while it's moving and run out again?
It seems unlikely, but yeah, that's
Final Destination 7 happening.
Yeah, right. Totally.
With the train scene, yeah.
Yeah, that seems
it's amazing, suspect. Yeah.
Another thing that I have.
I have a black cat.
Oh, hi. I've got a big orange cat. Hi. Yeah, I've got a big orange cat. I don't know where she is, but she was right there. Hi, Hannah. Oh, she's cute.
So sorry, Hannah, I don't want you around here, because just in case you...
Yeah.
What is this one here? Is this it? No, you know what? It's called the Blackpool trick. What it is, it's... the trick goes where you... you know, all this is going to be edited anyway. So here's the three diamonds, right? So you choose this one. And when I take it off the pile of the cards, let's say we use these cards here. Oh, I can't show you. Oh, maybe I'll show you that trick later. So you choose the four clubs. Okay. Oh, it's the three diamonds. So what I'm going to do, and then you write the four clubs on it, and you show the card, and it's the four clubs.
Oh, that's cool. That's great. Yeah,
that's a Blackpool effect. And then
nice.
I took an invisible deck.
Yeah.
And then Jay Sankey did one where he puts the X's in there. So you just have to choose a card. And the one that has an X on it is the one you chose.
Nice. That's clever. That's a nice spin.
Yeah. Or all the ones that you choose, all the X's, but the one you choose doesn't have an X on it.
Right. Yeah. That's really clever. There are a lot of really nice variations on the invisible deck. One of the ones I use, not in my show anymore, but I use it as an out in case something goes wrong, which does happen. David Regal has a variation called the Alone deck. It's the same, you know, premise, but it only has half the cards in one of them. So you can get a red deck or a black deck. And so, you know, you spread the backs of the cards and then like your one card is face up. And then when you flip them, all the other ones are blank. So the chosen card is the only card that's printed in the whole deck. So that's and it's the same mechanism, but it's a very, you know, it's a really creative play on the same plot. I've had that one. I always keep it in my little performing kit.
Yeah.
When I'm doing a show, because if something goes wrong, you always have to have an out, because spectators mess things up. I mess things up. It happens to everybody. So, you know.
What do you do when you heckler and said, you had it in your pocket, or you had it, and they tell you where you had it, but you actually had it there?
First of all, I always perform in a dress with no pockets, so that never comes up. But those people do exist. Usually, depending on how, you know, how that comes up, I usually make a joke of it. Just say like, you know, oh, you got me, it's a trick, or, you know, just try to make light of it. Usually the rest of the audience, depending on the circumstance, but most times the rest of the audience will be on your side. So if somebody's heckling and being annoying, you can kind of be like, yo, can you be cool? And they'll just like sort of, the rest of the audience is like, yeah, dude, shut up. So that's usually how I handle it. Part of that is because I have a background teaching. So I have a lot of situations where I have to be like, hey, can you guys stop talking or just like pay attention? You know, so this is kind of in my personal repertoire. But this is kind of, I mean, in the same vein as developing your own presentation for routines, this is something all performers have to like find the right way to deal with for themselves. So some performers will be like really harsh with hecklers and really like get in it with them. Or, you know, sometimes one of the things I'll do is if somebody's kind of heckling or being a little bit annoying or otherwise just like being a problem in a show, I'll try to pick them and involve them really heavily in a trick, so that they have to pay attention and they have to do something and then they like shut up about it. But that can backfire, because if they're determined to mess it up, then like you've given them too much power. So it depends, you know, there's a lot of sort of assessing the situation in real time and deciding what's going to be the best approach. And it doesn't always work. But, you know, it's one of those things where most audience members want to like you. So even if somebody's sort of fighting you a little bit, usually the rest of them will be on your side. And I find personally, if I can make a joke out of it, that's usually the best way to sort of diffuse it and move on.
What happens if someone stands up saying, I saw that trick and how they do it on YouTube? Okay, everyone, this is how she, have you ever had that?
Literally never had that in 12 years of performing.
Always wondered. Yeah.
It must happen, but I mean, I think that there's, so part of this is the venues in which I perform. So I perform in theaters and like magic venues and things like this. So standing up in the middle of a theater and doing something like that is a pretty bold, unusual maneuver. Like people don't usually behave this way, but I can imagine for like buskers or like people doing street magic that they could come up against stuff like that a lot more often. Or people who perform for kids, because kids are unpredictable, which I don't perform for kids at all. So that might come up more for like different types of performance situations, or even things like a lot of magicians will work at like state fairs and, you know, outdoor events and things like this that are a little more informal. And maybe that kind of thing could come up there. But I think it's the same thing. It just sort of scales up, you know, you just have to have like a prepared response and be like, hey, so you know what YouTube is, good for you. Or, you know, like some kind of like way to just dismiss it and move on and not give the person too much attention. I think that's kind of the move. But I've never really had that happen. I have had people approach me after shows and be like, hey, I know how you did such and such. I'm like, that's great for you. Like, it's, you know, they think they're gonna somehow like offend me, but it's like, yeah, it's on the internet. Like, that's okay. It's performance art. So if that's how you experienced it and you wanted to figure out how it's done, that's your decision about how you're consuming my art. It's okay. I don't take it as like some offensive thing that it's like a secret I have to keep, you know? So, and, but that's like a very personal perspective on it. I know different magicians have like very different sort of opinions about this. And of course, I don't want to like reveal how things are done. That's part of the nature of the art form. But, you know, it's not like a personal offense if somebody figures something out or somebody figures out how to look something up. Like, that's up to them. They can do that. It's fine with me.
When I was younger, a schoolmate and I went and performed magic in front of kids in the library. Mm-hmm. And you can get these magic tricks. Back in the 70s or 80s, you could get these magic kits where you could actually you have the rabbit in a hat, or you'd mm-hmm. have sure. it would be like not a real rabbit, but be like a foam
right,
rabbit.
Like a, yeah.
And you show the hat, and then you take out something.
Oh, sure. Yeah.
Gee, you know, this would be a good opportunity to do. I wish I had like a stuffed rabbit or something, or take my cat out of the hat. That would be sorry.
Oh, yeah, your cat might not be into that. I've always wanted to take my cat out of a hat. She would not, I'm certain she would not be into that.
Let's try. Okay.
My cat does love rope tricks, though. She loves it when I'm practicing.
Oh, yeah, you got a ginger cat, you said?
Yep, yeah, big orange. Yep. She loves ropes.
I have yet to seen, except maybe on the movie Prestige, where the black cat was duplicated yeah. like 10 times.
Yeah, right, which is really cool. It's a great
and they
movie.
Used a machine to yeah. duplicate him so he yeah, could do yeah. many of these tricks. So and cool. I know that people would think, what if a magician out there does use a twin brother or twin sister, yeah. but they don't tell you about it? But
could do.
Did you see that America's Got Talent? I forget what her name was. Not Josephine Lee, it was somebody else. But what she did is she showed Simon this trick, and then she went on a motorcycle and said, I know you like this. And then she revealed a motorcycle because Simon Cowell was a big motorcycle right. enthusiast. And then she gets on the motorcycle, and she drives it right into this cage, and this cage is lifted up.
And so I haven't seen this.
And then the cage
awesome.
Opens and she's disappeared. And then cool. she shows up over here on a motorcycle in the balcony and she goes, Simon. And they're like, you know, and they're looking.
That's amazing.
Yeah. So I'm thinking, how do you do that
one? Yeah. I'm not a stage magician, so I know very little about how these things work.
Yeah.
But
that's
sounds
way
like
beyond my yeah, but I'm pretty sure if I learn a trick, I can create my own and make mm-hmm. it work. But I did find my Blackpool effect.
Oh, cool. Yeah.
So what it is you take it out of the box and then you show that it's a real cards. I don't know if you can see them.
Yeah, I can see them. Yep. Mm-hmm.
And then you say, yep. Yeah, so, you know, it's red, you know.
Yeah.
And there's, this red, you know, this red button.
Yep.
So what you do, you choose a card.
Okay. Yeah.
This I'm going to cut out because this is one of my best tricks and I don't want people to know how I do it. So I'm going to cut that one up.
I agree. Good thinking.
So yeah, all these cards here, and then you got the one with the key. I wish I could show
really
you this
cool.
one, but it's hard to show in the front of the camera. But
yeah, a lot of these things are tough to do on camera for sure.
And also, yeah, and to do a magic show on camera, people are gonna think, it's been edited, it's not real live camera,
Right.
Only when you do it in front of people in real life will people wonder, well, how do you do that? Unless they figure it out.
Yeah, and we all really struggled through that during the pandemic performing on Zoom. That was a whole new frontier of like figuring out how to connect with an audience. That was hard. I'm glad it existed. I did a lot of Zoom shows while we were shut down, but it's hard to connect with an audience through a screen. Yeah.
And was it successful though?
Yeah, I think so. So I started really early in the shutdown. So, I mean, eventually everyone who's out working was doing some kind of Zoom shows. But when we shut down, I had a gig in St. Louis. My friend Amanda Lindsay, who's a fantastic magician, booked me to perform at a show she was putting together on March 13th, 2020. So that was the first week we all shut down everything. So it got canceled. But I'd already put together this 45-minute show. So I thought, well, okay, everybody's stuck at home. So I did a show on Facebook Live,
Oh,
which
wow.
now that we all know how to live stream, we know is a terrible platform for doing anything. But I didn't have a Zoom account. I didn't know what I was doing. We hadn't done it yet, So yeah, the following the like 20th or something of March, I did my first sort of live internet stream show. And it was good. I got about 100 people watching. And then I started doing that weekly, still on Facebook Live because I didn't know how to use Zoom yet. And every week I would raise money for a different charity. So I never charged for any of these shows. I always just did them to raise money for different charities. So I did like the local food bank here in Indiana and different food banks in different cities and feel like mental health support resources and things like that. Yeah, and so that was a really cool thing just for me to do. And I challenged myself when I was doing these shows that every show I was going to perform different material. So after I did this for about 10 weeks and then I couldn't keep it up any longer. I when I started, I was like, "Hey guys, I'm going to do a weekly show until shutdown's over." And I had no idea what I had committed to. So I made it 2.5 months and I was like, "Okay, I can't keep doing this every single week." But
No.
yeah, but that was okay because during that time I worked out a lot of new material. In fact, one of the routines that is in my Magic Castle act now is one that I developed during that period. So like it was a really productive time for me. But yeah, it was kind of a it was very one of the very hard things on Facebook Live over Zoom is that you don't even have a gallery, so you can't see your audience. There's just comments, and the comments lag by about 30 seconds.
Oh
So I would
no.
like say to the audience, like, "Hey, somebody name a card." And then I'd like sit here and be like, "All right."
Oh
And then
my
like
goodness.
30 people would be like naming cards and be like, "Okay, this is not, so there was a lot of
Yeah.
learning. Like,
Yeah.
so eventually we all figured out how to use Zoom, and that's a little better, because you can at least see each other. You can, like this, you can bring other people up and talk to them. So that's more natural. But still, you have to adapt things, like pick a card becomes a different process, or like, I can't see it, but can you, like the just the sort of assumptions are different, So, but yeah, I mean, I performed in the Magic Castle's virtual shows a few times, and it was actually really cool. I got to do my friend Fritz in Amsterdam runs a really great show there in person, but they were of course
Nice.
online like everyone. So yeah, I got to perform in Amsterdam online. So things like this, which kind of a silver lining that I got to make all these connections that otherwise may have been slower in regular times if it involved an overseas trip. So yeah, there were a lot of pros and cons to the sort of Zoom era of magic performance. I'm glad we were still able to do it. I had a really successful show for my birthday in 2020. I did a fundraiser show for Crisis Text Line, which is a like a mental health resource. And I raised $3,000 for them. And so that I was like really proud of how that turned out. And I had a bunch of my friends perform, and it was kind of my birthday party was this Zoom show. Yeah, so it wasn't the worst thing. I'm glad to be able to perform for live audiences again, because that's much better. But
Oh, yeah.
yeah, performing on screen is totally different, and there's this whole, we're in this era of social media magic, which is a whole other thing because, grabbing attention right away with something very visual and quick is not always how, you want to perform a trick or how you want to build a routine as you would for a live audience. So the hooks are very different than they are for like a traditional show in some sense. You know, and you have these 15-second videos, you know, like reels on YouTube or Instagram or whatever, that, you know, you don't get their attention in 2 seconds, they're going to swipe away. Like, so
I know.
Even that's super different, you know, but it's also, there's a lot of mixed opinions about, you know, the impact of social media on magic as an art form. And I think it's a different genre in the way that, you know, mentalism is different than card magic or stage magic, but it's, you know, overall, it's bringing more magic to more people. And like I said, as a kid, I was never exposed to magic. I didn't know anything about it. But, you know, more people are seeing it in like a casual context as they're just like browsing social media. And I think that's a good thing for the magic world. But
have you ever? Yeah, that's excellent. Yeah, Facebook Live. Like Facebook Live, I did a few, but it's just lagging. It's and especially when you're doing platform. No, it's not a good platform. What's a good platform is to do it in real life.
That's right. That's the best platform for sure.
And I like to have like a routine of maybe 10 tricks and then go and just casually be at a diner or maybe at a coffee shop outside or something and just go, hey, can you name a card? Sure.
Yeah. Okay. That's great.
I have a card here. I want you to take this, put the card in there and put your hand on it. And then as soon as they open it up, it's either empty or it's got a different card in there or whatever, or the piece of the card, you break it open.
Right, and it matches the,
And I know how to do that one too.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's a great trick.
Yeah. The trick where you can make a card appear in your wallet.
Oh, yeah,
Chosen card.
That's awesome. Yeah.
And to make a card, I've seen it where you can take a card, you rip it up, you put it in an envelope, you mix it up like this, and then you restore it.
Yeah.
So that trick was interesting.
Yeah.
Sorry, everyone, if you're watching this, that none of the tricks are going to be revealed here. And if we did reveal them, we edited it out. So there you go. The magic blindfold, how does that work? Can you actually see out of there?
So like, that's not something I've ever performed, but as far as I know, yeah, you can see. But I don't know how it actually works. I've never performed it.
But I've seen it. I don't know how they do it. Like they put the blindfold on and then they turn their face back and then the person will draw something like a cow.
Right. Or like hold an object or whatever.
Yeah. And then she'll say, you drew a cow. Like,
yeah, I don't know it personally. I'm also not a mentalist, so it's not a branch of magic I have a lot of experience in. But yeah, I mean, it's, and I'm sure there are different methods that different people employ. So, yeah, there's probably not just one way it's done.
So you're a cardician?
For the most part, yeah, I do mostly cards. I'm a close-up magician. I don't do a lot of coin work, and that's mostly just a matter of taste. I don't have any reason for that other than that I just haven't pursued it very much. Mostly cards, some ropes and rubber bands and cups and balls and things like this. But yeah, I mean, so just sort of stylistically, most of the routines that I do, I like to use sort of everyday objects. So, but they're well within the realm of typical magic. So, but like, for example, I always perform with like regular, like bicycle cards, right? As opposed to like, you know, there's all these like beautiful Phoenix decks. Yeah. Because I like the idea that this is like the deck of cards that everybody has in their kitchen drawer and just, you know, takes out to play Go Fish when their nieces and nephews visit or whatever, you know. And the same goes for coins or rubber bands or, you know, just small household objects. And again, this is a matter of personal taste in the way I create my own shows, but just I like the idea that it's using things that are kind of found in your house rather than some kind of like elaborate mechanism that like, oh, those are fancy cards. They must be tricky, you know? So that's kind of how I approach my, when I'm like working out a new routine or even like a full length show. There's a routine that I've performed a couple of times. It's very high maintenance though, but I really like it. It's basically Chop Cup. If you're familiar with this, it's a cups and balls routine. This is also a creation of David Riegel's. I really like his work. Where instead of a cup and a ball, it's a mug and a marshmallow. And so you do your cups and balls with like mugs and marshmallows. And then the reveal at the end is that you produce hot chocolate and pour it out of one of them.
Or you produce this large steel ball, which I've seen them do. Like a large
steel
ball.
Oh, yeah. That's
like that.
Right.
You can't put that bowling ball. up your sleeve. Right. Like, how did you produce a bowling ball?
Yeah, I mean, I guess just the point I'm trying to make, as opposed to like some large steel ball, is that like hot chocolate and marshmallows and mugs are all things we like have in our house, you know? So like stylistically for me, that's something that works as opposed to a large prop. Also about like, you know, producing very large objects. You can't tell, but I'm pretty small. I'm 5'2". So I like little things because I'm pretty short. So yeah, that's part of what draws me in. And yeah, that's just developing your own style as a performer. You know, everyone can't perform every single type of thing. And there's a lot of value, I believe, in authenticity and sort of style and character, you know, and a lot of performers will approach this very differently. You have performers who present entirely in some character, for example, Carissa Hendricks's Lucy Darling character, which is amazing. And she does very flawlessly, but it's a written character and acting. Whereas like in my presentation, I perform as myself. I use my real name and talk about my real life. So that's a different approach. That's just different for different people. So yeah, I guess in that vein of authenticity, I like to choose routines in which the props sort of suit me in some very natural sense.
Yeah. I've seen a few tricks, which I'm just mesmerized thinking that must have taken 20, 30 years to do.
Yeah, some do. I mean, there are tricks I've worked on for, I mean, I haven't been doing this that long. I'm not that old, but I ones that I've been working on for many years to sort of perfect, either presentation wise or just sleight of hand wise.
And to become natural to you.
Yeah, right. Yeah. So everything I do in my close up act now, or maybe 60% of it, are tricks that I've been doing for like 8, 9, 10 years. They've sort of settled into how I present them. And they're essentially the same every time. And I don't want to say they're exactly the same every time, because they're not, because that's the nature of live performance. Is that, you know, like every experience with a different audience is going to be somewhat different. But just in terms of like the structure and the presentation and kind of the scripting, for the most part, they've kind of settled into like how I'm going to ever present them. But there's other ones that like every time I perform it, you know, there's a little bit of evolution. So I think like, oh, I could handle this slightly differently, and that's going to make that like a little look a little cleaner, or I could put in a line here that's going to make the plot make more sense, or, you know, and you learn those things as you go. So yeah, in terms of like things taking decades to master, that's very true. But I think that in some ways, something can be a, you know, a great trick with a great presentation, but then across the decades that it gets performed, be just perfected over time, and really like, a performer can really like get so familiar with it and like just make it their own in a very detailed and specific way that just develops over time.
So when you created a trick and you perfected it, have you ever sold your own creations?
Yeah, I have a few tricks on Penguin. You can just look me up on Penguin Magic. Yeah, I haven't done a lot. I just sort of haven't gotten this far yet. I do have a lecture that I've given to some different magic clubs, and a never-ending series of notes, or like maybe a book eventually, that I've been writing forever that is not anywhere near presentable yet. But yeah, someday, I don't know. I've done a few. Some people have asked if I intend to market the trick I did for Fool Us. And as of right now, no, I'm not planning on it. But, I don't know what will be in the future. But yeah, I mean, that's a route that many magicians take in creation. And I think, you know, it's a fine line between sort of having your own material, especially if you're performing it regularly, versus sort of getting it out there, and even especially making a living at it. You know, this is one of the ways in which people can make a living as a professional magician, is creating content for other magicians. Personally, I don't make a living as a magician. So I have the luxury of not pursuing those routes if I don't want to. So yeah, so, you know, I've got a day job.
Yeah, because you're a mathematician, I think, at a
university. Yeah, that's it. I'm a professor. Yeah.
Professor. And do you ever kind of like show them a mathematical magic trick just to get your point across? Or do you separate the two?
I mostly keep them separate. So it varies. It depends. So it depends on the class and it depends on the sort of situation. So for example, when I'm teaching like a much smaller class and I really develop like a relationship with the students and they sort of know me, usually, first of all, usually they find out because they look me up online or they see me on TV or whatever. So usually they figure it out anyway. But so, you know, if I know the students, then sometimes I'll occasionally, if it fits in with the material in a nice way, I'll do a trick that's like part of a lecture. But that's quite rare. One way I usually share is like I'll be invited. So like, for example, last fall, the math club at IU invited me to come to one of their meetings and like, you know, answer questions and then like do some magic for the math club. So that's like a sort of extracurricular, like it's not like during class. So I'll do stuff like that. I volunteered at a lot of events around like engaging, for example, young women interested in math or science and teaching them like math-based magic tricks. Yeah, so those are really fun. And that's a cool way to get like kids interested in math or magic or both. That's, you know, especially young women, which is really exciting. But yeah, so one of the things, though, one of the times I keep it really separate is when I'm teaching like very large classes where I don't feel like the students really know me or I don't have quite the personal connection, because there is nothing worse than having a bunch of students who are like in a calculus class at 8 a.m. that they like don't want to be in. And then like, I try to show them like a fun, cool magic thing. And they're like, what is this? We hate this. We don't want to be here. And it's like, okay, this is like the worst setup for an audience ever. Like, you know, so that's like, that's a lose-lose. Like, so, you know, you got to kind of feel the vibe and see if it's, if they're receptive, because sometimes they're not, for reasons that have nothing to do with magic, just that, you know, or like they're stressed about, like they have an exam coming up and they're like, why are you wasting your time with this? We need to learn what really, you know, stuff like this. So it's just, it's not always like the appropriate setting, but when the occasion arises, it's a fun thing to share, but that's not always.
Yeah. What's the card at any number one about? I know you have to use mathematics for that one, but that's an interesting
so there's lots of, yeah, that's a premise that I love. That's one of the things that is in my never ending notes is one of the approaches to doing this. So I guess for anybody listening, a can or any card at any number is exactly what it sounds like. It's, you know, a spectator names a number and another one names a card or something like this. And then that card is in that position in the deck. And yeah, there are a lot of mathematical approaches to this. There are a lot of sleight of hand approaches to this. It's actually a very broad class of tricks because there are a lot of different ways to achieve that outcome. And it's historic, like it's a classic of magic and it's, you know, something, it's in some sense a very natural thing to do with a deck of cards and a very amazing outcome. But yeah, there are some kind of mathematically driven techniques towards accomplishing it. So some are more, I'll say it like this, some are more realistic than others in terms of how much math you have to do in your head to make it make sense. So, and I'm saying that as a person who does math professionally. So that's, you know, and that's actually something in general that you have to think about a lot when creating tricks or routines or anything really, is this realistic to do? Like, you know, you can come up with like a really clever idea for a sleight of hand thing, but if it's too hard, like you're not going to do it. No one's going to do it, you know? So there's kind of a fine line between like accomplishing something amazing versus like, this is not a realistic way to approach this, you know, or like you have a technique that is not reliable, you know, so it works with like 50% of the time, like you're not going to take that on stage because like you don't want it to fail for an audience. That's, you know, so there's kind of this challenging yourself, but thinking carefully about like, is it going to work? Yeah.
The best trick I ever did. Well, that's a good answer. You like that one, mathematically. But the best trick that I like is the one where you you have them choose a card. And let's say they choose the nine of spades.
Okay.
And then you mix it up. Now, I did this one of the accommodators at on a train trip to Niagara Falls.
Oh.
Told him I was a magician. So mm-hmm. I told him to choose a card. He took the card and I did it in a way where put your hand on this or whatever.
Sure.
And then I told him then whatever I did. And then he looked at the card. He couldn't find a card in the deck. So I took out my wallet and then his card was in my wallet.
That's great. That's
and
a great trick.
He started just, he lost it. It's like, how the hell did you do that?
Yeah. That's
and
great.
The one, yeah, and the one where you choose a card, and then you flick it, all the cards all over the place.
Oh, so, sure, yeah.
And then you grab the card.
Yeah.
From the
those
air
are great.
Say, is this your card? You know, and like, how did
you
do
there's
that?
Some,
you know,
very cool variations of that. Like, I've seen one around, like. You know, you shoot the cards so they're all and like maybe there's a balloon, you take like a knife to the balloon and the balloon pops and like the chosen cards on the knife, things like this. Those are all like really great, very dramatic visual reveals, which always play really well.
Yeah, Jay Sankey sold a kit on several versions how to do the signed card.
Mm-hmm.
And but the coin tricks are always difficult for me. And
for me too, I have very small hands.
Like, have you, that's true. Have you done the trick where you put a puncture hole in the card and you can move the hole?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. I've not personally been familiar with it, the hole punch one. It's really great. You see it a lot on social media because it's very visual and it's a really cool trick.
Very visual, taking the hole and having a coin and putting the hole in the coin.
Yeah.
And you're taking the hole out of the coin and you put it back in the card and like I'm just my mind is blown
so
on that one.
Yeah. It's so good. Yeah. Yeah, I worked through a little bit of Bobo's Coin Magic, which is one of the sort of standard texts when I first started doing magic. And I just found that like I mean, when I was early on, I had like a coins across routine that I had in my act that I eventually stopped doing. And when I was doing those Facebook live shows, I started working on a coin matrix. This one where they're in corners and they're under cards and they move across. And they're great tricks and they're classics for a reason because they're always good. But I just, it didn't, first of all, they're very hard. So, but that's never been, I mean, I do a lot of very hard tricks, but like they didn't, I never felt that I connected with them the way that I do with some of the other things in my routine, you know? And I think there's something very analogous to like being a musician that there's certain genres or styles of music or instruments that different musicians connect with or like excel at, you know? So for me personally, it's mainly cards. But that doesn't mean I don't work in other things, you know? But that's, and that's kind of something you, I mean, if I could give one piece of advice to anyone, and this is a piece of advice I got early on learning magic, is try all the things. If something looks interesting to you, try learning it and see how you feel about it. But that it's okay to just like shelve it. If it doesn't work for you, that's not, you didn't fail at it. Like, not everyone has to do certain types of things.
Yeah, like I'm a classically trained tenor, and there's certain songs that I will do and songs that I won't do. But when it comes to magic, when it comes to magic, the Blackpool effect, I really wish I could show you how this is done because I was part of a church magic crew, like the Church of Christian Magicians, and all of them, they showed you their trick and how they did it. Mm. I showed this one guy who was a magician. He could, an unbelievable magician. I showed him the Blackpool effect. He liked it so much, he made him his own. And then when we got together again, he showed me it. I'm like, wow, you do it better than I do.
That's funny. Yeah, and, I mean, that's great.
Yeah, and then there's a few tricks they did, which I remember seeing when I was 6 or 7. And I was like, you're showing me how that's done. I'm like, that's how they do it? Really?
Yeah, of course. Right.
No way.
Yeah, sometimes it's much simpler than you would anticipate. Yeah.
Yeah.
That was one of the things I really enjoyed on after my Foolish segment aired on Reddit and on YouTube. There's people trying to figure it out and people come up with really wacky stuff, like way more complicated than the way it actually worked. Like my favorite was a long thread of people arguing about it being like that my board was like some kind of electronic display and that it was like this super high tech thing and that it was just like designed to be super realistic and all this stuff. I'm like, nah, it's just a piece of plexiglass. Like, but you know, it's people love to overcomplicate their explanations of how they think things are done. Sometimes it's amazing how simple it can be.
Yeah, and some of them need assistance as well.
Yeah.
Like an assistant.
Right.
Who's actually
right.
in the audience. And yeah.
Yeah, right. Planter. Yeah.
That's very interesting.
Yeah.
I love your YouTube channel.
Oh, thank you. Yeah, I'm not very active, but I'm trying to be more so. It's kind of tough because it's hard to decide on, like, I just started posting those shorts or reels or whatever. What are they called? Shorts, I guess.
Shorts on YouTube. Yeah.
And they're that thing I talked about with like social media magic, that the hook is different. You have to get attention right away or people aren't going to watch it. And that's really different than, you know, a show in the theater where they have to sit there and listen to you. But that's been kind of a new fun challenge. But yeah, a lot of the stuff on there are just kind of like random shows I've done here and there. But yeah, I mean, I prefer to sort of perform out in the wild, like if it's at a theater or for, you know, I think one of the videos I have on there is for like students in a classroom at some point, you know. But yeah, it's a good way to sort of connect. You know, one of the amazing things that happened, you know, over pandemic time, obviously we're all at home and we're all online all the time and we're trying to like socialize like normal people. And one of my favorite things that happened was, you know, I was doing these online shows and I was getting people viewing them who I didn't know in real life, you know, like strangers. Who I've since met in real life since things reopened and like become friends with. And that's like a really cool, you know, like that wouldn't have happened if we weren't all, you know, stuck at home and just looking for something to do online. So yeah, YouTube's like a good venue for that as well. I've definitely connected with a lot of like other magicians and just like different people. So it's nice to have for sure. Yeah, but creating content is hard. That's a whole other level of like, you know, you're not just like, I've got my, you know, my backdrop from my Zoom days and everything, but like, you know, creating consistent quality content, like that's a full-time job. Like people who have these like, you know, so I have a great appreciation for that. So, you know, I try to put up things that are good, but it's slow because... You know, it's a lot of work.
So you said you had a closer. What's your opener?
For like in my shows.
Mm-hmm.
I open right now. So I'll talk about my most recent show. So a month ago, I performed for a week at the Magic Castle in Hollywood. I was in the close up gallery, which is exactly what it sounds like. It's a room that seats 26, I believe. Yeah, so right now the show I'm performing in there, I open with my Foolish Trick. It's on a much smaller board though, because it's a small room, so I can't fit the giant whiteboard on there. But besides that, it's the same routine. And then I close with, it's a trick, it's called Chicago Opener, ironically, it's my closer. But I have a presentation for it with, I present it as, it's hard to explain, you can actually, maybe you can find it, I don't know if it appears on my YouTube channel anywhere, but basically it's with an envelope prediction kicker. And the premise I give for it is around being pen pals. And so like I do a thing where you're like writing a letter to like somebody in the audience is going to be my pen pal and you reveal the card. Like you got to see it. But yeah, so that's an original in as much as it's an original routine, but the core of the trick is a classic of magic called Chicago Opener, or Red Hot Mama, it sometimes gets called. And it has to do with a chosen card being a different color than the rest of the cards. But yeah, the presentation is totally original. And that's one that I developed during my Facebook Live show phase. So yeah, those are sort of the bookends of my act. And in between, I just do a few other. So I could do McDonald's Aces, which is a classic trick. Professor's Nightmare, which is a rope routine. So these are, you know, standards of magic I've written my own presentation for. And that's how I string them together into a show. It's the
Well, the rope routine's been over 50, 60 years. You think it's getting old?
I think it depends on how you present it. So, like, I have an original presentation for mine that I've gotten good praise for from other magicians that they haven't seen it presented that way, even though it's a very much a standard. I think there's a lot of room for creativity in rope magic that I think is not always exercised. But I don't think it's getting old at all. I think what is old is presenting it precisely with the pattern that was on the little sheet of paper in the trick you bought. You know, I think you gotta freshen it up. But I think that can be said for anything, ropes or otherwise. A lot of things have been around for 50, 60, 100, 200 years, and it doesn't mean they're not good. But sometimes they require some freshening up to make them current and just like something new that we haven't seen a million times. You know, I mean, you can make that argument for something like cups and balls, which is very much a standard of magic and you've seen everyone do. Yeah. But you know, there's lots of fun ways to make that original. And I think therein lies the responsibility of the performer to bring you something that is ultimately entertaining. So how can you make it entertaining? Well, make it new and interesting. And how can you do that? Well, put yourself into it because you're your own person. So yeah, that's, yeah. So to answer your question, no, I don't think any of these are getting old, but I think it requires a little bit of work to make it not old.
Well, tell me a little bit about this David Regal that you like so much. What's about his work that you don't?
Oh, he's just really creative. So he has a lot of books. Let's see. I'm by my bookcase right now. I'm seeing if I can pull any of them out. Oh, maybe I can almost reach it. Hang on. But yeah, he's just, he's very active around the Magic Castle. He is or was on the board of directors for a long time. And so I've seen him perform a lot. And yeah, he sells a lot of material. So this is one of his books that I really like. It's called Approaching Magic. This is the book that had the hot chocolate thing that I mentioned. But yeah, I mean, there's a lot of other creators that I, you know, that I like. I just happened to bring them up twice, so that's worth mentioning. But you know, as far as books go and just creators and content, like for anybody who's trying to get into magic, my first textbook, well, we're right here and I'm right next to my bookcase. Sorry, it's kind of a lean. Everyone should own Mark Wilson's Complete Course in Magic. This was my first magic textbook. It covers all types of magic, like up to like creating stage illusions. And this one's really special. Mine's signed.
Nice.
He passed away this year. Yeah. So cool. That's yeah, but he was a, you know, a TV magician from the 60s who was really pivotal. And he created this textbook is really, really special because it covers a lot of different branches of magic. So there are a lot of standards of card magic and coin magic and like guidelines to creating bigger illusions and boxes and stuff. And you can actually build them based on this text, which is kind of the right way or a good way to get started. Because you build a lot of foundation doing that, you know, and you get a lot of taste for different parts of magic and sort of developing what you like. So that's one that I think Mark Wilson is an important figure in magic texts, I guess. And while we're plugging creators and books, I'm going to pull out one more just because I just happen to be right next to my bookcase. Like I didn't plan this, but sure. I mean, I'll just give you a peek. This is the, yeah. So there's
a lot of magic books there. Wow.
Yeah. I mean, I'm a professor, right? I love books.
I hope there's some mathematic books on there.
Oh yeah. There's some math books too. There's both. This is a great, if you're, there's a bunch of volumes. I have 1 through 4. I think there's 8, but also a great standard card college, for anybody doing card magic. So yeah,
actually I'm a book shows you how they actually show you how it's
yeah,
done.
Yeah, so oh. There's a lot of there's diagrams and stuff.
Wow.
Yeah, and I know a lot of people are very resistant to book learning, and there's so much video content out there that, of course, there's a lot of, you know, especially with streaming and instant downloads and stuff.
Yeah.
There's so much content. Like the stuff I've created for Penguin is almost instantaneous. You just download it and learn it and you're out there doing it. But I guess, you know, maybe I come from a somewhat unique perspective just as an academician, as a professor. I like learning out of books. So, but just in terms of developing foundations and ultimately being exposed to a lot of historical content, I'm a big advocate of mixing it up and using both resources, learning from books and from, you know, downloads or DVDs, even. That's sort of like an in-between era of magic instruction. When I was first getting started, you know, I got a bunch of magic DVDs because it hadn't, you know, these sort of instant downloads, sort of the technology wasn't there yet. So we're, you know, that's a more modern era of, like I kind of came in right on the cusp of that being a thing. So, you know, even YouTube magic, like that's developed a lot more over time. So yeah, you know, I mean, there's lots of different ways to learn magic. There's no one right way. You know, you hear stories about people who got into magic just by going to the public library and they found a magic book and that's how they started. You know, it's different for everybody, or like the common young person who like, oh, I saw this on YouTube and did it this way. Like all of them are right. It's just, you know, there's no wrong way to learn. So yeah, you'll hear a lot of sort of purists saying the only way to learn is from a textbook or, you know, whatever.
Yeah. And what do you think of the saying where they say a lot of the good magicians don't wear sleeves, because you don't have you can't put anything in your sleeve. You just wear a t-shirt. You can make things disappear. And you're like, well, it's not in your sleeve. Where is it?
I always perform in an evening gown with no sleeves. So I never have sleeves. Yeah. So either an evening gown or a cocktail dress, they're always sleeveless. So I like that sentiment, but I never have any pockets either, though, which is kind of it makes it hard. But you know, I just adapt my material. It's a personal choice that I choose to wear dresses or, you know, present a certain way such that I don't have sleeves, I don't have pockets. But you know, that's another challenge that I guess I agree with that sentiment.
That's very interesting hearing all about you and exactly what you're passionate about. Yeah. Now, what's your favorite type of mathematics?
Well, so I do research in a branch of formal logic called category theory. And basically, the best way I can sort of talk about it is that it's we kind of approach it as it's kind of an abstraction of abstract math. So the idea is that what we like to do is you take like sort of a structure in mathematics, like a collection of functions or the real numbers or just some like mathematical like structure. And then you go sort of a level of abstraction where you want to say, okay, I want to work in this framework where I know very little about it. I'm allowed to talk about objects and relationships between objects. And then you say like, okay, what information do we know about how those things behave? And then you can say, okay, then what does that tell us about the original thing we were trying to situate in this framework? So that's kind of in like four sentences, some of the stuff that I think about. But yeah, it's very loosely related. Well, it's not that loose, but it's a neighbor of theoretical computer science. So it's not like directly just like how your computer works, but there's sort of formal logic is really about expressing mathematical ideas using just some rigid framework. So whether it's just a very specific language like zeros and ones that a computer uses to get information. So it's like you study these sort of, we'll call them syntactic frameworks of like, here's my language and here's what I can say with it. And here's what I know just about how the symbols interact. So like a computer can use. And then you say, okay, well, if you know that, what do you know has to be true about the stuff you can say? And you say, okay, well, this language is describing this part of math. So what does that tell us about this part of math? So that's sort of, that's kind of the, yeah. So it's just super abstract and made up. And so like, I mean, I actually use this as a line in my show and it sounds like a shtick, but it's not at all. So like, I just wrote a paper where I proved that, here are the words, that you can realize fractals, or you can find fractals like the Sierpinski carpet as the final coalgebra of a functor on a category of metric spaces. Like, that's a lot of words, and that's, and it's real and it's true, and you can Google that and you'll find my paper. But like, it's you know, it's all super technical, and obviously I've been doing it for a billion years, so it's not like accessible. So one popular follow-up question is, what's the point, or what's it for? And the short answer is, it's knowledge for knowledge's sake. So, you know, and that's sort of a tough one to sell to people who aren't in it, but basically we're just figuring stuff out, and maybe it'll be used for something, or maybe it won't. Like, you know, a fun sort of toy example of that is, if you're familiar with A Beautiful Mind, there's a movie about this mathematician, John Nash. Yeah, so he was a real guy. And the point is that he was a mathematician, and he came up with this sort of these principles in game theory, which is an abstract part of math that wound up getting applied to all kinds of like economics and different stuff that in his figuring out wasn't like the point. He was just solving some math stuff, and then it wound up being a thing. So, you know, to say what's the point, like, what's the point of trying to figure out anything? It's, you know, we're understanding math better, which someone might use for something else to do something at some point, but that's not my responsibility as the mathematician.
Will a lot of your movies be, your favorite movies be about mathematics, like Beautiful Mind, or anything dealing with magic, like The Prestige?
I like both.
Yeah.
In that I do both. Yeah. Or just movies that are none of those. My favorite movie of all time is 2001: A Space Odyssey. So, but yeah, I mean, I like both.
Was Good Will Hunting was that one of your favorite movies? Because it had to deal with.
It's a great movie. It's also just a great story. Like, it's a mm-hmm. it's a good movie. Yeah, and they have a depiction of they got a Fields Medalist in there and some. Yeah,
that's interesting. Yeah, that's really good.
Yeah,
that's awesome. Wow, you're very interesting, very wonderfully talented. Now, tell me about the musician part of you. What's this whole playing the theme song of a BoJack Horseman on your guitar?
My favorite show. I don't know. I've always played music, but it's just that's my like. I think I have maybe two YouTube videos where I'm playing music. It's not really a thing I do in public a lot. It's a little messy. I'm not going to show you. The other half of this room is my music stuff. I grew up playing piano and guitar. I was in marching band. I was on the drum line. I played a bass.
Oh, yes, the drums. Oh my goodness. Yeah. Wow.
Yes. I played drums.
Amazing.
And I was just in like a garage band all through grad school. And we just played for fun and like played at open mics and stuff. We weren't like we didn't get booked or anything. We weren't like a money-making band. We just played for fun. It's just something I've always done. And I still do for fun, mostly by myself. Or, you know, with friends if I can coordinate it. It's just a thing I've always done. I love music. I love going to shows, and you know, I've got that thing where I'm covering the theme song of BoJack. That's just a thing I did. I don't know. Yeah.
Yeah. What about the music you would choose for one of your magic performances? Do you have song?
Nope. No. I've never performed magic to music. No.
Wow.
And which is kind of unusual. I think I really like to talk. I all of my presentations are always like spoken through. And that's a common thing for performers to like do a routine, especially visual routine to music. It's not for lack of interest. It's just never sort of struck my fancy that it's like a thing I want to do. Like, yeah. Maybe I'll work up to that. But I think just in my personal style, like that's how I connect to the audience as I talk to them. So, it's a presentation style that I do really appreciate. It's just not one that I've tried.
What's your feelings towards misdirection?
Um,
Is there a lot of that in your card magic?
Oh yeah, definitely. I think that this is one of the things that we had a very hard time with on Zoom because you can't see your audience. So, you know, people are generally pretty predictable. So you can take advantage of the fact that, like, if I put my hand up here real fast, you're going to look at it, right? So, you know, and that's like a small, stupid example. But, you know, when you make someone two-dimensional and put them on a screen and that the sound and the visuals and everything is contained, it's not the same. So you're not going to be able to take advantage of the same sort of like psychological predictability of a live audience. I think misdirection is really important to all magic. I think that there are very different ways in which it is carried out. So for example, there's literal, like, you know, misdirection of, like, you know, you do something visually somewhere to draw people's attention while something else is happening elsewhere. But I think there are more subtle variations of it that we do throughout routines that maybe are not even that explicit in, like, the, you know, guidelines of a trick or something, where it's like you'll do something like a move or a slight or whatever in such a way that it's slightly off the beat. So you're like talking and it happens like in the middle of a sentence or somewhere you wouldn't expect to, like, focus. And that falls under the purview of misdirection, but it's not exactly like directing an audience member's attention away from it. It's just like doing something in such a way that their attention is not naturally going to be on whatever you're trying to conceal. So, it's an important part of all magic. I think there's a lot of subtlety to using it effectively and doing so in such a way that is not overt to your audience. And I think that's something that develops over time too, because, you know, you can tell if an audience is like, you know, over time as you with more experience performing, you can look at an audience and you know what they're looking at. So, like, mm-hmm. if you're, you know, doing something tricky and you look out and they're all just burning holes in your hands, like, you know, so that's something that where, like, as you become more familiar with a routine, you know when those moments are and you know to talk over it or to make a joke at that moment or to do something that warrants applause and do it during that. Or, you know, there's different ways to sort of direct the audience's attention. And like to use it effectively is just like all of it. It's just a skill that comes over time, lots of time.
Well, I know I'm going to have to reveal some trick here because sure. Thing is, you're a cardician, but yes. You can also use any type of object for a card as well. Like, for instance, sure. Okay, everyone, just plug your ears.
Right.
When you're doing a card trick for once, like a diner or for a restaurant, and you have sure. someone choose a card, mm-hmm. and then you rip out the on the one of the corners,
yeah,
yep, and then you give them the card and the card disappears, mm-hmm. then you're going to end up finding out that the card that they chose with the missing piece is inside a salt shaker.
Oh, sure, yeah.
And then you take the piece and you put it together and it matches. You're like,
yeah.
How did you do that? I know how it's done, and that's as far as I'm going to go, people.
That's good. I also know how it's done. Yeah. And it's a great trick. And it's, I guess that's kind of what I was saying before about how I like really like tricks using like mm-hmm. everyday objects that are just exist in people's worlds. You know, there's something very strong about that, because then you're, as the magician, as the performer, kind of getting the credit in the audience member's mind for like adding magic to these objects, you know, as opposed to like, here's my tricky contraption that you've never seen before. Something's happening in there, you know? So I think that's a very strong premise or approach, is especially when they're objects that like belong to the spectator or like are on their table or just, you know, that you didn't introduce into the situation. I think that's very good.
I knew this that's a very good answer. I like that answer. I knew this guy who was a magician. It was a trick I really liked, and I asked him if he could teach me how it's done. He said, yeah, so for 1 hour I'll teach you how it's done, $200.
Whoa.
Yeah, it's quite that's a good long. Trick, and he deserves it. But if someone came to you and said, I want you to teach me a trick or whatever, would you charge them? Like, do you have a course? Do you have a magic course?
I've taught courses. Yeah. It would depend on the situation. So, yeah. I mean, one of the great things about the magic community is being able to collaborate and learn from each other. That being said, a lot of marketed effects are out there in such a way you can pay the creator to learn them, like the ones on Penguin or Vanishing Ink or books. But yeah, like a particular person. Personally, I've taught courses and I've given like lectures to clubs and stuff, and I do charge for those things. But that's in the context of like a class or a lecture. If I had like an individual approach me, if it was somebody I didn't know, I don't think I'd take them on. Though that is a common thing. People who do like private lessons or tutorials and things like this. I personally don't, but it's definitely a thing. If it was someone I knew, like another magician, like a colleague or just someone I know, I'd be happy to share. But then again, there's like different layers of that. Like I would maybe share it and direct them to a resource versus like direct one-on-one, like teaching every step. Like those are different sort of levels of instruction in some sense. So yeah, I think it would just vary by circumstance. Yeah.
Did you ever perform the signature card one? Signed card.
Yeah, I mean, there's a lot of routines with signed cards. It's a popular thing for like an ambitious card routine where it comes to the top.
Ambitious card, yeah.
Yeah, I've done that. The sort of Chicago opener pen pal routine I've been doing is with a signed card. Nice. There's the anniversary waltz where they're signed on the same side or two sides. They wind up being two sides. Yeah, I really like signed card routines. Actually, the one I've been doing where it's a signed card, I actually do the signing, and this was for like COVID reasons. So since reopening, when I do my close-up act, I don't have spectators sit at my table with me anymore, which I used to do pre-COVID times, just for distance. And so, the whole premise of the trick is that I'm going to be pen pals with this spectator. So on the signed card, I write a little note and say to so-and-so, and I write their name on it and sign it from Jory. So it's a signed card, but I've written it. But there's nothing tricky about the way I write it. I just don't want to pass it back and forth. So... I've definitely done various signed card routines. And one of the reasons I really like them is that you get to give the signed card to the spectator as a souvenir, and people love that, you know, which is really nice. Especially, it's one of the benefits of writing my name on it, is they see it and they're like, oh, right, I liked her. Let me look her up and follow her.
That's great. I love that. Yeah. And Jay Sankey does things where he just talks his things. And you know, and you take this card and instantly... it disappears and it turns into a pen or something. And just the way you talk and the way you express yourself gets you to the point where you're listening to the person, but you don't see them do the sleight of hand.
Right.
It's gone, you know?
Right. Yeah. And I guess that's what I was saying about the beats of your performance and the moments at which you do things. And when you're talking, you're interacting and making eye contact and these kinds of things can definitely make or break a performance for sure.
Yep. So I'm going to show the tricks that I have for everyone in the audience. I'm thinking of actually, like, I want to ask why you don't, you can sort of incorporate your music talent with maybe a card routine if you just work at it. My thoughts would be with this one, this is my Blackpool effect, where you can actually spectator or choose a card, and then the magician chooses the wrong card, but then he says, oh, is it really? So they turn it on the back and they write the name of the card spectator has chosen, and the card turns into that card. So that's my Blackpool effect. This one is called the lock and key effect. It allows you to there's only a few cards in here, maybe about 25 or 30, and then I would flip through it, and then you would choose the card and then see this business card. That would be your business card with your name, your phone number. So people who like this will call you and say, we want more.
Right.
So you take that card, you put it in between the card, and you lift it up, and then they see the card that they chose, be like three diamonds, boom. And then you do a routine and you instantly have this black bag affair, black bag. And the card they chose is not only in here, but it's got the hole where the lock was on.
Oh, nice.
And it's still locked.
The lock. Yeah.
So I like that one. And then there's the one I told you, the Listerine, where you can have the card, the torn off corner of the card appear in there. So what I'm thinking of doing is I'm actually going to go through all my routines. Do I have any more here? Oh, they're basically all different types of cards and all different types of bags. And I'm going to work on a routine. Oh, here's one. I'm going to maybe take the best two or three cards, tricks, and the best non-card tricks that I know, and just going to have a routine, and that's all I'm going to use. Because I tried coin tricks, like for instance, this coin trick here. You see it?
Yeah.
Now, watch me bend it. See? Now it's bent.
Oh, nice. Yeah. Oh, it looks good.
But, you know, if I just go like this, I can actually put it back to normal again.
Nice.
But, I mean, there's a way to do that. But you got to do it in a way where people say, you know. So I'll probably end up getting like 7 or 8 tricks all set up and ready. That's good. Then those are the ones that perform. But there's always like, I don't want to be an illusionist or anything. Oh, that's another group. Yes. Another company, Illusionist.
Oh, yeah.
You can buy magic tricks.
I would be wary of Illusionist. They're a little bit, so I think that they have had some bad reputation around pirating material. So just be a little bit careful. If you see something on there, look it up and see if it appears in other places. And if you can buy it directly from the creator or from if it's a Penguin or VI effect, just be a little bit careful because there's a few of them out there that are a little questionable, but
okay.
I have one routine prepared I can share with you if you'd like me to. I'm starting to get a little bit hungry, so I don't know how much longer I'll be. Don't be. This has been a lovely conversation. But I'm going to have to tip you down here.
Sure.
Get you to my table. Make sure we can stay.
Ladies and gentlemen, Tori Noquez, magician.
Hey, I'm here. All right. Okay, let's do it. So, So, in most situations with playing cards, typically the most important type of card are the aces, right? So, let me go ahead and show you a little demonstration with these. So I know we're a little bit out of frame for a second, so give me a moment to get them out. We'll make sure everybody can see everything. All right, so we got the 4 aces here. So let me just give you a little, here we go. Okay. All right, 4 aces are kind of the most important cards in the deck. In particular, the ace of spades is like really special, right? It's got like the bicycle logo, I guess is what we call that, right? Mm-hmm. It's also what we as mathematicians call an accumulation point for the set of aces. Now you may or may not know the topological definition of accumulation point. Doesn't matter for what we're going to do here, but all you need to remember is that these 3 aces tend to accumulate around this ace of spades. Okay, remember that it's A for accumulation, right? It's right on the card, so you can remember it. It's gonna be on the exam, so okay. All right, so let's do our demonstration here. So I'm just going to tuck these other aces under these little piles here, like so. So they're under some little barriers. And I'm going to take this ace of spades right here, and I'm just going to put it right there on top. So Chris, I have an important job for you. All I need you to do is keep an eye on this ace of spades here. You can watch what's going on, but just make sure it's right there. Okay. So face down, still there. Yep.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Good.
Got it.
Okay. All right. Perfect. Okay. Commencing demonstration. Here we go. So let's start with the ace of, what do we got? Diamonds. Okay, so I'm just going to turn that guy over and give it a little wave over that ace of spades there. And if we did that right, that ace of diamonds should have vanished.
Oh, wow.
All right. Yeah, right? It's weird, isn't it?
Yeah.
Right, well, don't worry. There's 2 more. All right. So up next, we've got the ace of clubs. All right. So I am just going to take that Ace of Clubs and give it that same little wave over that Ace of Spades. And Chris, I can feel you watching me like a hawk, man.
Yep.
I don't know if you saw it go, but that Ace of Clubs has now also...
What? I swear I was watching you.
I know. It's okay. We got one more. We got the Ace of... What we got here? Hearts. Okay. Mm-hmm, so I'm just going to bury it in there.
I'm watching
it. A little wave. I know you're doing a good job. A little more. And hopefully, if we did that right, that Ace of Hearts should also be...
Oh, wow. That is incredible.
Thank you. All right, Chris, I had an important job for you. Were you watching this Ace of Spades the entire time?
Yes, yeah? I was. Good. Yes.
Okay. And then I hope you remember the special property. It was what we called an accumulation point for the set of aces. Remember that, right? All right. So right here on top, we should have what? The Ace of Spades. We put that there, right?
Yeah.
But then accumulated around it, we should find hearts, clubs, and diamonds.
Wow. That's incredible, Tori. I love it.
Thank you.
That's incredible. So, wow. You're
one
good.
One of my favorites. Thanks.
Yeah, I like it too.
Oh, thanks.
Wow.
All right. Well, I think I might need to wrap it up because I need to go.
Okay. I really should maybe do like a video of this trick, Black Bull Effect.
Sure. Yeah, I'd love to see the full trick. That'd be
and
great.
And then show you how it's done.
I would love that too. Yeah, it seems like a great trick. I can't wait to see
everyone. Only she gets a chance because I don't want anybody to know how this is done because I performed this in front of a lot of people. Right. And they still don't know how it's done. So I'm not
That's
telling
amazing.
Them.
It's good.
And one of my other favorite ones, the lock and key one, I'll show you how that one's done.
Yeah, I can't wait. Looks great.
So I like do videos and I might put them in like a Dropbox or something. And
like an unlisted YouTube video or something.
Definitely.
Yeah, that'd be great. Yeah. Fantastic.
And I'm not asking you to share something with me either. I just like to share these two to you. Thank you, Tori. I hope we touched on a lot of things.
Yeah, thank you for having me. This was a really fun conversation. Thank you.
You're very welcome. And I hope that we can continue this because I know that you're going to love this Black Bull Effect.
Yeah, I'm really looking forward to seeing it.
Yeah, everyone, press the subscribe button for more content. And also, I'm going to have all the routines for Tori. Not how she does them, though. But all the routines she does, and then you can figure them out yourself.
That's it.
Awesome.
Yeah, Penn & Teller had to, so.
Yeah. That's another thing about Penn & Teller. I don't understand how they can say, well, we know how this is done, but how would you know? Is it the routine that you know how it's done, or is it the way she did it how it's done, you know? So it's like they don't want to give you an FU trophy.
Right. I mean, that's the goal, right? I know. It's pretty. It's good.
That's awesome. Okay, so.
Well, thanks again for having me. This was a pleasure.
You're very welcome. So what we're going to do is we're going to end this stream, and I really appreciate it. And you're welcome back anytime. And
thanks.
And but this is going to be, this is a fun podcast. This is going to be great when it's posted and everything, because I love what we did. I love hearing from you and all your answers. Excellent. I really appreciate it, Tori. Oh, so you better go and have your dinner now.
Yeah.
So, let's wave.
All right. Bye. Thank you.
Bye, everyone.